So it turns out that building a table together doesn't mean that we're gonna be filing for divorce anytime soon, right? Oh, okay, never mind.
Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop, sponsored by
MicroJig, maker of the Gripper. Work safer, work smarter.
And by Centipede Tool, manufacturer of the Centipede Portable Work System, the ultimate in portable work support. For more information, visit centipedetool.com.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. So on today's episode, we are going to be covering the construction of this absolutely gorgeous table that my wife helped me build. In fact, this was completely inspired by her idea, and we worked together on making this happen. So we're going to talk more about that a little bit later on in the show. But really, this farm-style table was extremely easy to build, much easier than I thought it was going to be, and that's for a couple of different reasons. Number one, I had some assistance building it, which makes it go that much easier. But number two, when it comes to the turned legs down here, I'm not ashamed to say that sometimes I'm going to turn to an outside source to help me get materials so that I can work on my projects and build them and be successful with it. And so these legs actually were ordered several years ago, a long time ago, and I promised I was going to build a special desk for my wife, and we ordered these from Osborne Wood Products. There's a ton of different legs that are out there. We probably could have gone with something a little bit bigger, but because we had these laying around, it's like, let's go ahead and use these because it's going to work perfect for this project. That's probably one of the number one big things in there. And of course, like I mentioned, I'm going to say it over and over, I got a lot of assistance with putting this table together. Now, the materials for it, we actually have three different types of wood in here. Those legs are actually a poplar. Originally, we had planned on painting them, but we ended up, of course, staining them. They look fantastic. The apron down here is actually six-quarter maple. And then the top, surprisingly, we were getting a lot of questions about this when I was posting pictures of this on Instagram and over on my Facebook page for the show. A lot of people were asking, like, is that barn wood? Is that some sort of rustic maple? What is this? And to be quite honest with you, because you're going to see it anyways, this actually turns out to be just simply number two common utility boards that we picked up at a local home center. It took a little while to kind of sort through the stack, find ones that were nice and flat, and more importantly for my wife, having the characteristic of something like a barn wood, but at the same time for me, double checking to make sure that they were structurally stable, we ended up finding these boards. And in case anybody was wondering, yes, we ended up putting the pile back in position because I did not want any of the people working in the wood area to be upset with me for just leaving piles all over the place. But anyway, so that's what we have here, the three different styles of wood. We've got the pre-made legs, and of course, like I said, we've got the assistance coming in from my wife to help me build this. So let's go ahead, jump right into the construction portion of this build, and we're gonna do that down in the workshop. And pretty much I did this part by myself, which worked out great because once I had it all put together and ready to be assembled, I was able to bring it up and she took care of all the staining, which we'll also see in this video.
The only part of this table that's being built from rough stock is the apron. And as a result, we needed to first joint the 6/4 hard maple on one face before running it through the thickness planer. Now that was easy enough for the short aprons that'll be on the ends, but for the long aprons along the length, I didn't feel like messing around with them on the joiner, so instead I broke out the thickness planer sled that we built for the tall dresser, and I took care of flattening them with that. Once that first face was nice and flat, I just simply flipped them over and ran them under the cutter head, and I did both the long and the short aprons at the same time to get them to the same final dimension. The next task is to rip the aprons to width, and we're going to do this over at the table saw. So I first need to true up one edge square with the flat faces. For the short aprons, this is a rather easy task to do on the joiner, but for these longer ones, I decided to take the thickness planer sled and convert it into a bit of a ripping sled. Once that first edge was all squared up, it was just a matter of readjusting the rip fence and then ripping all the apron pieces to their final width. At this point, the only dimension left to cut is the length, so it's a trip over to the miter saw to make quick work of it. And we'll start first by squaring up one end, then we're to flip it end for end to keep the same edge against the miter saw fence, measure it to length, take our square, scribe a line, and then we're going to make that final cut. With the apron pieces cut to final length, it's time to draw our attention to marking for the dowels we'll use to attach them to the legs. I start by locating the center of the thickness of the apron pieces, adjust my marking gauge to that dimension, and then scribe the line. Then using this small jig that I made to help me line up the dowels on all the mating pieces, I line up all the pencil marks, and then I grab my drill to start marking where I need to sink the holes for the dowels. I only need to drill a little way in to get started. Once I'm all set, I'll then remove the jig, and then I'll carefully complete the drilling action to the desired depth. Once they're all drilled, I'll just double check the results with some dowels. To drill for the dowels on the legs, I'll again scribe the line using my marking gauge, which I've readjusted so that it's centered on the leg. And just like we did previously, we'll grab the jig, line up the lines, and this time, rather than using the drill bit in the drill immediately, I took it out and I'm going to use it by hand to leave a mark so I know exactly where to start drilling. At this point, all the holes are drilled and it's time for a test fit. And after a little bit of persuasion to get it in, it looks really good. So now we only have a few more holes to drill and we're all ready for the next step. And that next step? Well, that's out in the garage, and this is where my wife Samantha steps in and takes over. She's doing the whole finishing process for us. So here she is applying the stain, and then eventually it was onto the top coat.
Yeah, that's it.
So while Sam was busy applying the finish, it gave me an opportunity to run back downstairs to make the corner brackets to help hold everything nice and tight when the table is actually in use. I started with some scrap poplar that I cut a 45 degree miter on one end. I then measured for the length of the brackets that we'll be needing, set up a stop block, butted it up against it, and started making my cuts. As soon as I made the first cut, I then just simply flipped it over and made the next cut. And I went on to repeat this process until I had four corner brackets. From here, I headed over to the drill press to drill the angled cuts I'll need to secure it in place. To help hold it in position at the right angle, I used the remaining scrap it was cut from, braced it against the drill press fence and a stop block, and then I chucked up a step bit from my Craig pocket hole jig. After the first hole, I just flipped it around to drill the second hole, and then eventually I readjusted the fence so I could move it over to line it up for the next set of holes, and repeat the entire process. While I'm here, I also want to drill for the hanger bolts we'll drive into the edge of the leg when the bracket is in place. This is easy to do once we swap out the drill bits and readjust the scrap poplar to hold it in position for this configuration. Once all the finishing was completed, it's time to start assembling, and Samantha's going to do most of this part of the job. So she starts by first squeezing glue into the holes on the legs for the dowels. Then doing the same thing with the short aprons, and then finally inserting the dowels. And then with a little help from yours truly, she gets the joints lined up and starts to bring everything together. She then clamps the first set of legs and short apron together, and eventually she'll go on to repeat the process with the other set. Once both sets have had time to dry, it's out of the clamps, and then she'll repeat it all over again to finish assembling the long aprons in place. Now these ones need a little more persuasion to fall into position, but once they're fully seated, it's then just a matter of applying some clamping pressure with the band clamps. And of course, there's a little finessing to get everything lined up, but eventually, they're ready to set aside and dry. Now, before we remove the band clamps, we want to install the corner brackets by driving the screws into the four holes on each one. Once they're secured in position, I can come back with a drill bit that's sized for the hanger bolts and drill straight on through the hole that we drilled earlier on the drill press. As it turned out, doing it this way made it much easier to insert the hanger bolt and then screw it in position. and as soon as it was securely in place, I then came back, removed the nuts, I then added a washer, and then I reattached the nut securely in place with just a few turns. So at this point, this leg joint is about as solid as it's ever going to be. The only final touches left of this table are to include a few cross supports to help hold the tabletop in position and support it along its length, and then finally to attach the three pieces that make up the top.
And that's all there really is to the construction of this absolutely gorgeous farm style table. Again, kudos to my wife for one, coming up with the idea, and number two, and maybe more importantly, helping me construct this so we could get it done in a timely manner and taking the burden, and by burden I mean the things I don't like to do, off of my hands and doing the finishing process for me, and even to some degree the assembling process. That part's not so bad, but when it comes to the finishing, I hate it. I cannot stand it. So again, huge thank you to her for taking that off my hands. One thing I do want to do real quick before we start wrapping this up, and I say real quick, it won't be that quick. We're going to talk about the joinery and then the tabletop itself. I know a lot of people are going to be asking, why did you go with something like dowel joinery? Why did you not go with something more traditional, say a mortise and tenon joint? And to be quite honest with you, dowel joinery is actually something that's rather traditional when it comes to putting together table aprons to table legs. They work fantastic. They're easy to use. And especially on these long apron pieces here, which are somewhere around 7 feet in length, 6 feet, 7 feet in length, that could be very daunting to create a mortise and tenon on it the right way. There's several different ways we could do it, but for certain, it could really, it could become very daunting. It could be rather difficult, but doing the dowels made it a lot easier. But regardless of what I end up doing, whether it's the dowels or the mortise and tenon, or heaven forbid, I use pocket hole joinery to pull those together, the main thing is having those corner brackets that we built, having those in position. That's really where the strength for these aprons is going to come in. That really pulls everything together, and you can make them in the shop like we did with the scrap poplar we used, or you can purchase pre-manufactured ones, either wood or metal, and put those in position. And once you get them dialed in, once you put them in position, get everything attached with that hanger bolt, that is a super strong joint that is going to hold this whole thing together, because even if this was a much smaller table, I would still want something there to add that extra structural support, because even if we were just simply passing around napkins or maybe a cup of tea or something, it's amazing how much stress the legs and the apron are going to get. And I know for a fact we're going to be moving this back and forth to accommodate all of our guests that are going to be coming here, so I want it as solid as possible. Another thing that I want to mention in here is when it comes to the tabletop itself. So these, again, just in case you missed it earlier, these are basically number two common pine boards that we picked up from the home center. And so therefore, the one thing I have proportionally that I wish I could have gone back and done differently, but I didn't have anything at the time, was go with something a little bit thicker. I don't know if I would use two-by material. That tends to be a little bit too wet still. But if I could have gotten my hands on some boards that were could have been finished down to about an inch and an eighth, maybe an inch and a quarter, something this big, because this table is about 8 feet in length and about 34 inches in width, having a little bit thicker tabletop would add to the proportions of this and make it just look really, really good. But we're still really happy with what we have here right now. Another thing is when it comes to these defects, as far as I'm concerned, other people are calling them personality traits or characteristic traits or whatever you want to say that takes something ugly and makes it look better. Ideally with some of these, especially these knots down here, there's a really great one. Probably could have came in with some epoxy, filled those in, and made them structurally more solid. But again, my wife really likes the idea of maybe these even potentially falling out at one point and adding even more characteristic look to the table. So we're just going to go ahead and leave those the way they are, kind of keep our eye on it. At least I will be for certain. One last thing about the tabletop that I want to mention is the way that we attached it, of course, is that we used pocket hole joinery for attaching it to the apron itself. One thing I like about that is the fact that it is going to allow for expansion and contraction. We live in Michigan. We are now, as we're recording this, heading into the most humid months of the summer, which means that this table has still potentially room to expand a little bit. And then it's, in the winter, it's going to go ahead and contract. And considering this is a three-season porch that is unheated, this table is definitely going to be feeling the effects of all of those seasons. So having the pocket hole joinery in there is going to help to allow just enough room for it to expand and contract as needed. So for the center board that we have here, we have two, which are placed about, I'm not really sure about the dimensions here, so look, about a third of the way into the board, and then on the other side, a third of the way in. So two for that one, and that's also on the ends of the apron, and then those structural supports that we put in the center here. We have two on each one of those. For these outside boards that have this hangover, which is about 4.5-inch hangover, I have one on the short apron, and then I actually have them, the pocket hole joinery on the apron itself to hold, pulling it really, really tight. And I made sure again that these also are going to potentially expand and contract as needed. So we are all set there for the expansion and contraction. Well, actually, one more thing I should mention. Here we have, if we look at this again, we see that there's some slight gappiness between the boards themselves. Again, laying to the idea of this being very rustic and very, it has a lot of personality. I didn't joint these edges where they met together. I just let the boards be what they were. And the nice thing about that is it actually left a little gappiness in there. So again, as these expand and contract, that's not going to be an issue. They're just going to maybe bump up against each other a little bit, and we're all good. So the table is actually working really, really well for me. So that is, I think, pretty much the only things that we really need to discuss. Maybe one more thing is just those under supports that we have here in the middle that help along the middle. What we're doing, the reason why I did those, I did three of them. We probably could have gotten away with just a couple of them. The main thing I was thinking is, especially for this center board, the outside ones are supported by the apron. The center one, quite obviously, if there was nothing to help hold this here in the middle, my just pushing on it like this could potentially cause it to bow. So I can only imagine if we had, say, a big centerpiece or a big platter in there, it would bow. So that's why I made sure to put those in there. If this was a shorter table, I don't know if I might put one if I needed to do that. But for certain with this long table, we ended up putting a few in, and it did a fantastic job. Excuse me. I had a little burp there thinking about some of the food that we just had. It was just amazing. Gastronomy is awesome. So anyways, though, if you have any comments, questions, suggestions, I love hearing from all of you. You can email me at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. And if you want to leave a comment in the show notes for today's episode, you can do that over at the website at mattsbasementworkshop.com. And of course, if you're watching this over at YouTube, you can leave a comment over there. So until the next time, I will be talking to all of you soon. And who knows, maybe by then I'll have been out here a couple more times having an amazing brunch or dinner or whatever we're going to do out here. Until then, straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.
Thanks for watching. For more information on topics discussed in this episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com. Also, please consider becoming a patron of Matt's Basement Workshop. Get early access to new shows, bonus content from each episode, and so much more. Visit patreon.com/mattsbasementworkshop to sign up and start receiving your benefits today.